Hello, Michael from Red Chair Diaries, coming to you from my library in Nova Scotia, Canada. It is Friday, January 18th, 2019, and I wanted to hopefully keep this short, but I do tend to meander and wander and lose my thought process. But I want to talk about some of the books that are queer literature or tinged with LGBTQ aspects or intended for that audience. Okay, so my definition might be a bit liberal, but these are things that I've read recently in the last few months. So I want to, this is one I just finished a few weeks ago. Most of my books are ebooks from the library. And then if they're on sale, there's several sites that will send you discount ebooks. You know, the publisher might be looking for a few extra shekels. And I don't usually spend more than $10 on an ebook, $10 Canadian, $10.99 maybe if I'm pushed, because I like to be able to see my books when I'm sitting in here. And of course, I can't see the ebooks. I can only read them. So that's Edmund White, The Unpunished Vice. Now, he's a very, very famous author with the what you call the literati, people who read so-called literary novels and so on. He's not a famous writer. He's not like a Stephen King or an Anne Rice or... Oops, hold on. Okay, I'm back. I don't get a lot of phone calls, but I actually got one. Okay, where was I? Oh yes, I was talking about The Unpunished Vice by Edmund White. I've read one book, one or two books by him over the years besides that one. I read one called Boy's Own Story, which actually is quite good. But he is a very literary writer, meaning he's excellent, but he's not exactly a page turner. You know, you do have to devote your energy to actually getting into his mindset. He's very well read, and I think he's quite an interesting man. I think he must be in his 80s now. I know he lost a lover, I think, to AIDS. I think that's mentioned in this book, and I don't know if he's got another one or not, but he's interesting. Anyway, I'm one of those oddballs who like reading books about books as well. So he's talking about books he's read over the years, and a lot of them I haven't read a lot. I mean, he's going into a lot of philosophy and Greek literature and things like this, as well as some mainstream authors he's talking about. But I found the book actually endlessly fascinating. I like having people talk about literature. I've always enjoyed that. I enjoyed that at university in literature classes. I don't want to write any more term papers. I've done enough because I've taken so many classes beyond my first degree, and I'm tired of writing and talking about books and to that extent, you know, doing autopsies on them. But I do enjoy reading that. So if you're really into books, it doesn't matter if you've read the books he's talking about. He's fascinating, and particularly as a famous queer writer, if you're gay and you'd like to be in touch with queer literature, it's very interesting. So I get most of my books like this at Kindle or Kobo, and I try to get them on sale. Now, I'm going to move on to this one, Boys Keep Swinging, which is a memoir, a sort of autobiography, by Jake Shears of the Scissor Sisters. This, I got this one on sale, I think. This is a very, very good book. I ordered this, downloaded this one, because I saw him on Seth Meyers' show, I think, a few months ago. So I got the book. He's very interesting, you know. He's been out for a long time. And basically doesn't give a shit what he says or does, you know. And he's always in touch with his feminine side. He likes to wear, as in this the group Scissor Sisters, which he started, but he also will wear dresses on stage and things like that, you know. He's strange, but interesting. And now he's in his 40s, so I don't know if he's going to calm down. I mean, why should he? But the book takes us from his childhood, and of course the usual thing that happens to a lot of us in school, you know, if you're a bit odd, as I was, meaning I wasn't a prototypical butch young man like my eight brothers. I don't think I was super feminine, but the point was is that I, you know, people have radar about these things and they can pick you out, you know. So he talks about that part of his life, and then he goes into the family situation and a divorce between his parents and living in the Pacific Northwest, and I think then living in I forget the other place, like a hot place. I don't know if it was Arizona or Florida or whatever. But he's lived in a lot of places. He's had a lot of adventures. And then when he was getting into the music and going to university and all of that, he had even more adventures. And so he talks about various boyfriends and things. And then the way Scissor Sisters started and the trajectory of that group. Very, very, very interesting as far as I was concerned. I quite often listen to the station from England called BBC2, and I would hear this disc jockey at night, Anna Matronic, and I didn't know that she was from the Scissor Sisters. You know, that's a made-up name that she gave herself in the group. She was the only female member of the group. And she does DJing over there, because I knew she was American just by her voice. So, but I've never had a Scissor Sisters album, and I've only just seen them on TV a few times. So I didn't really have a grasp of what they do, you know. I've put a couple of YouTube videos on just to see what they're up to. But I was interested in him, and I was interested in his story. And I think particularly if you're a gay fellow, it doesn't matter what age you are, I think that you'll enjoy his story. And he's not painting himself as a wonderful person in this. I mean, he could be a real asshole, and he was several times, and it's in the book. And I think that he's probably matured now to a certain extent. But I really, really enjoyed reading Boys Keep Swinging. That title comes from quite a famous David Bowie song. Now, this one. Less. Less is a novel by Andrew Sean Greer, G-R-E-E-R, and it was a winner of the Pulitzer Prize for presumably fiction. It's kind of like a fictional memoir, I guess. I don't know the fellow. But it certainly has very, very good reviews. And also it wouldn't have won a Pulitzer Prize considering that over like 50,000 books are published a year. So, you know, it rose to the top on a lot of lists, I guess. So I said, oh, this sounds interesting. And I didn't care for this book at all. Now, this one is also very literary, but it just didn't hit me. He's kind of like on a travelogue bent in this. He's going from place to place, ruminating on a past love who was supposedly getting married to a fellow soon in the context of the whatever the time frame is in the book. And so there's a lot of this going back in the past and thinking about things. But for some reason, award-winning or not, I didn't think it was that fresh. I mean, extremely well-written, but it just didn't do anything for me. I found it kind of a chore in a way. But, you know, it was, I guess, was for other people, and that's the point of literature. Not everybody's going to like what you're doing. Anyway, I read it. There's certainly a lot of enjoyable things in it, but I can't say that I was crazy about it. And I summed it up on Goodreads as less is less rather than less is more. Now, this goofy one, it might have been a free one. I get these free, weird, queer-centric novels listed on something called, what is it? Ebook Bargains of the Day or something. So I get this email every day with a bunch of books, and then they always have something free, but they always have these gay romances at the top of the page. And so I got this one. I don't know if it was $1.99 or not, but it takes place, I think, around the turn of the century, and there's a whole series of them by this fellow, I assume it's a fellow, Charlie Cochran. Quite often women are writing these gay romances, not men, so I don't know if Charlie's a man or a woman, actually. But this takes place in Cambridge University in England, and it is, like, I think around the turn of the century, the turn of the last century, like the 1900s. So it's basically Edwardian, I guess. And how these two guys end up getting together, and I can assure you they didn't look like that in as I was reading the book and coming up with what they looked like. It was a rather modern look there for these Edwardians. Pretty silly. So there's a whole series, and I guess they solve murder mysteries at Cambridge. Now, I've been on Cambridge campus more than I've been on the campus itself. I was in the one of the libraries that's mentioned in here when I was taking my MBA, my first MBA, actually. And we spent a week in England, and that was one of the places we went for a dinner. So I've been at the Cambridge University, not as a student, not by a long shot. So that's where it takes place. And one of them, I guess, recognized that he was gay, and the other fellow didn't even understand what gay people did. He was so sheltered. And I thought, considering they're teaching, one of them's teaching math and the other one, I don't remember what he's teaching, but they're young professors, basically, or lecturers, as they're often called in England. And I thought, give me a fucking break, you know? I mean, there's being sheltered, but then there's just being stupid. And anybody who's teaching has access to some kind of literature, and stop being such a prissy little thing that you don't understand anything about sex. Stop it. Stupid. And so this is one of the gay books that have no cursing, swearing, and not much in the way of sex. I can tell you that. Lessons in Love. Look it up at Kindle and see what you think. Charlie Cochran. What else? Oh, now this one was something else. Conduct Unbecoming. I think it was a free one that came down on that list, and I thought, oh, it's some two guys in the Navy. One of them is an officer or whatever, and the other one isn't. And that part was all very interesting about not being able to get together and cross ranks, and that it would ruin your career and all of that. Pardon me. So I enjoyed that, learning that. And it takes place in a Japanese military base. I guess it's Okinawa. See, when you don't have the physical book, I can't take a quick glance and figure it out. These are just covers. I probably deleted the books. So Conduct Unbecoming, and they're both hot, as you wouldn't believe. They both have kids. They were both married. And there's all of that sort of stuff going on, and, you know, are they going to be able to make it? And so I think there's a few sequels. I know that there's other Conduct something else. And, I'm not interested in following the story, but I didn't mind this one. This was actually quite decent light reading, you know. Not a great novel, but light reading, two guys who want to get it on. Get it on and trying to find a way to get through, you know, the bureaucracy so that they can actually, you know, protect their love. So Conduct Unbecoming by L.A. Witt, W-I-T-T. Now, this is one of the best. This is nonfiction. Peter Ackroyd's done many, many books over the years, which I have not read, but I think he did a very famous book on London, just called London, and it was a biography of London. So in this case, this is a history of queer London, and it starts in the Roman times, maybe even before that. I don't always remember the details, you know, once I put a book aside. But I thought this was hysterical. I mean, it's not nice, all the things that have happened to gay people, but the stories he's telling from the Roman times up to the modern days, I thought it was very, very funny. And he's talking about all the different areas that were notorious in, say, Dickensian London, between the two world wars, going back even farther to the Regency times. Very, very interesting, you know. I mean, sex has not changed, I would assume, in several thousand years. But the being able to access queer sex is quite interesting. He has many passages about transgender or transvestitism, but I think in many ways that transgender characters in the history of London, which I thought was very interesting. He's talking about guys who have lived as women and women who have lived with guys, lived as guys, that sort of thing. It was quite fascinating. It brings us back to the famous adage that everything old is new again, and everything new has basically been done, you know. So there's nothing new about gender fluidity at all. It's just whether you can talk about it or whether you put labels on it, you know, that's all. But it is something that happens and happens and happens. I also bought this on a discount quite a while ago, or did I? Or maybe I borrowed it from the library. I don't even know anymore. Leonardo da Vinci, this fellow, I see him on, I think, MSNBC occasionally. Walter Isaacson, he's a professor, I think, at Tulane University, and has written lots of biographies, but he's a history professor, I believe. And one of his famous ones was a few years back, the one about Steve Jobs. I think that's how you pronounce his name. I always call him Jobs, but it's Jobs, which I have a copy of. My sister gave it to me, but I haven't read, but I have it. But this one here, I wanted to read, a famous homosexual artist and inventor and so on. You've all heard of Leonardo da Vinci. Leonardo from Vinci, that's all that means. But this ended up being just a tad too long for me, but I finally got through it. He doesn't make all that much hay out of Leonardo being homosexual. I thought he might have had a bit more, maybe, I don't know if analysis is the right word, but I ended up being kind of disappointed in this book. But at the same time, I can't really slog the book because it is what it's supposed to be. It's a biography of Leonardo da Vinci. And there's a lot of paintings in it where he explains the techniques of Da Vinci, which I found very interesting about how, at least Isaacson and other historians, I guess, and art historians, explain how Leonardo basically invented certain styles of painting about which way the light was going to hit the subject in the painting. How the background, was it going to be out of focus or in focus? These were very interesting bits of the book, I thought. So, I don't have talent for painting or anything, and so I don't understand all the technical aspects of it. But I did enjoy reading that part, actually. So that's that. And I don't know if I have any more. Oh, Call Me By Your Name. Now, this is so similar to the movie. Yes, whole sections taken out and put in the screenplay. Screenplay won an Oscar last year, I believe. And I did enjoy this book, but at the same time, I found it way too antiseptic, you know. Like in a book, sometimes you'll get more of the passion in that, and there really isn't much to it. It's not a terribly long book, and there isn't much to the movie. So, if you really like the movie, I think you'll like this book. I mean, I forget what they actually changed now between the movie and the book and the movie, but it isn't all that different. So it's an easy read. And once you've seen the movie, I read this after I saw the movie. I could picture those actors in those roles, and so that, I guess, helped. I didn't come up with them myself. I already had faces in my mind. But it's simple. It's not. It doesn't break a lot of ground, I don't think. But Call Me by Your Name, kind of benign. And is that it? And that's it for now, because when I'm running up to over 20 minutes, I know that you tend to doze off. Anyway, it's Michael from Red Chair Diaries. I've wanted to talk about some of these books for quite a while, and I shall see you around the tube.